So welcome to lecture number 15. We will talk about algorithmic considerations for the numerical simulation. So the outline of that lecture is as follows. We will talk about data structures for model representations and how they can be efficiently evaluated. And then we will talk about numerical integration. So what is Euler's method? What is Runge and Kutta's method? And we will talk about adaptive step size and some other methods, the so-called predictor-corrector methods. And then later also apply that to a biological system, the glycolytic subsystem, and see what the effect of stiffness is there. In the end, we will talk about some advanced modeling concepts, events, and rules, and also talk about runtime considerations. So how can we efficiently represent a biological system in data structures that we can use for dynamic simulation? Let's look at some reaction system. So here we have now a more complex pathway, the glycolysis. And there are two reactions that we now pick out from that, or actually three that are here in that table listed. Two reaction channel one and two that converts fructose 1,6-bisphosphate into dehydroxyacetone phosphate and glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, and then the second reaction channel converts dehydroxyacetone phosphate into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. So three metabolites and two reactions here in that system. So now let's talk about graph theory. So how can we represent that in data structures? So we need to define what a graph is. So a graph is composed of vertices and edges. So those edges connect the vertices. So vertices are here drawn as circles, here labeled with numbers, and the edges connect them. These edges can be directed or undirected, but not mixed. So if they're directed, we call the edges arcs. And there can be weights associated with these edges. So a directed acyclic graph is a graph that doesn't have direct cycles in it. So you can see here an example for it. There's no cycle. It almost looks like a cycle, but if you end up in node number 6, you can't go anywhere from there. And now a path is a sequence of edges that connects the nodes within a graph. So here we move from node 1 to node 3 in a sequence that we call a path. Yeah? Now a tree is a directed or undirected graph in which any two nodes are connected by exactly one simple path. And a root node is a node that doesn't have a parent. So here, the root node would be number 1, and a leaf node, which is here number 3, or also number 5, those would be nodes that don't have further children. Yeah? So that is, in brief, graph theory that we need. Now, how can we represent our reaction system with two reactions as a directed acyclic graph? So we have two reactions, and here are the mass action equations for that, as you can see. Now, we make a data structure for us that we call the model, and it has reactions, parameters, and metabolites in it. So we keep the metabolites separate from the reactions, because the same metabolite can participate in multiple reactions. Therefore, it is makes sense to not repeatedly write out the details about it, but instead to make links from the reactions to the metabolites. So now let's take a look at reaction number one. So it has participants, and these participants are here now linked through edge weights. And these edge weights are the stoichiometric factors and the kinetic expression. The kinetic law is now represented as a binary abstract syntax graph, or AST, that you can see here. And now, if we want to know what the values are of certain leaf nodes, then we have to look up those current values in the data structure. And that is done by doing linking to the rest of the data structure. So we can look up what the current value at a certain time point is for a node in that graph. So if we have now two reactions, that means we have also two rate equations, and therefore here two abstract syntax trees that are here in our sense binary trees. But it doesn't always have to be binary. There can be multiple nodes. If, for instance, we had more participants than two here, a product node could have multiple children. But as you know, in biological systems, that doesn't usually happen. We usually have only no more than two molecules that come together. But you see, when you go from top to bottom, you basically make the calculation. So if you have a minus node, and that minus node is connected to a multiplication node, and that means k minus 1 times fructose 1,6 bisphosphate, so then we go up, so we get that multiplication, then we go to that minus node again, so we have the left-hand side of that, and then evaluate recursively the other side, and that gives us the rate law for the first reaction. And in the same way, we can also represent the second one. So what the computer does internally is everything is stored in such a form where we link the participants and also rate constants within a graph. Now, if we want to calculate what the flux is at a certain time point, we have to recursively evaluate our model. So note that is being done for one time, so the time is now fixed. So we start at the root node of the model, then we traverse the entire model data structure. So we start at the first reaction, and then if the current node is a leaf, then we have to check if the node is a number, then we return directly that number. But if it's not a number, then we have to resolve or look up the symbol identifier and find out what is the current value at that specific time point for that node. So if the node is not a leaf, then it's an internal node. So we have to perform arithmetic operations with the children as arguments. For instance, we have to multiply the children and so on. Whatever node we have, multiply, subtract, divide, whatever the internal node defines. And then recursively evaluate the children and return the value. So we have to repeat that procedure over and over and over. That means for every time point at which we want to evaluate that model, we have to go through that entire procedure. And therefore, computational complexity is very important. So what is computational complexity? It's actually a science by itself. I like to make a few statements just very briefly. So basically, we have to count how many operations are necessary to evaluate a data structure. And that gives us kind of a measure of how long the computation time will be as an approximation. So we define a cost function, and that is the sum of the costs of all individual operations that an algorithm has to perform. And in our simple assumption, we just say that every basic operation has the same cost. Is one per operation, and then we just count. We do the same thing for also the memory consumption, so not only the time that is needed, but also the memory to evaluate that data structure. So we have to count how many items do we have to store. So we count one storage position per item, and then sum up how much storage is needed. So, and we can do that for our rate law here, and that tells us that for such an abstract syntax tree here, we have to assume that we have a memory and evaluation consumption here that is on the order of number of nodes and number of edges in that syntax tree. So we use here the O notation. O is a set of all asymptotic functions that are function g times a constant c. Yeah? So now how can we speed that up? So if you have now our two rate laws here represented as trees, we want to speed up the algorithm to evaluate that. So what we notice is there's actually an overlap between the two reactions. The same metabolite participates in both reactions. Therefore, we can find out, we can save actually effort for looking up the current value. You have to think about that. So the concentration is not constant. At every time point, it can be different. Therefore, we have to look up the current value again and again. So if you can reduce that effort, that will dramatically reduce the runtime. Also, we see that there's an overlap in the two trees here. We have the same multiplication happening two times, and that is happening at the same time point, and therefore we can actually merge them, because if we evaluate the first reaction, we will already calculate the multiplication of dehydroxyacetone phosphate and glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. And once we have calculated that, we can actually store that value here directly in the multiplication node. And when we evaluate the second reaction, then we can reuse that already calculated value. It's going to be the same at that time point. Therefore, we don't have to make that calculation again. And also, the lookup can be simplified because we already looked up a gap once and can directly store the current time value in that node and don't have to look it up again when we need it once more for the next calculation. So that speeds up the procedure. And as you will see now, when we talk about numerical integration, that is really very fundamental, of fundamental interest. So how do we integrate that system now? So far, we only talked about how to evaluate the system at one time point once. Now the question is, how do we calculate the time derivative and integrate? So first of all, let's talk about differential equations in general, what they are. Here is a first order ordinary differential equation system. That means we have here a unknown n-dimensional vector function y that depends on a variable t. So we don't know what y is, but we know what the derivative of y is. So the derivative of y is described by a vector function f that also depends on t, the variable t, but also on the current values of the vector function y that again depends on t. So basically, we have here a function f that is defined on a domain omega, which is a part of r, the real numbers times r to the n, and mapped to a n-dimensional real value space. That means that domain here is an open set, and that defines the function f. Now we need initial conditions. That means we need a time zero that we define. In our sense, it will always be zero because we're looking at biological systems where zero time is assumed to be the initial time. And then say what is the value at t zero for y. And we call that y zero, and that's a vector again. And that is going to be in omega. So the solution satisfies that at time zero, if we evaluate the function y at time zero, we will have y zero, or y naught. And that means that we have n functions y, yeah, with n dimensions, I being 1 to n, and we have n known functions f, f prime, that specify that derivative. Yeah? So now our goal is to find an approximate of the unknown function y, which is basically given by the integral of that function f. Euler was a famous German mathematician that had an idea how to approach that. So here you see a picture of him. He lived in the 18th century. And his idea was to basically start at the known value, at the initial value, and then approximate the unknown function using the derivative at each time point. So he says we use a constant step size of delta t and divide the time range that we are interested in into equally sized portions, each delta t long. But of course, the smaller delta t gets, the closer we get to that dt. But dt is infinitesimally small, so arbitrarily small. Also have to think that Euler didn't have computers available, so everything had to be calculated by hand. So it was very handy to make certain fixed steps. So basically what that means is we move from dt to delta t, and therefore the equation simplifies from what is written here to the left, dt y to delta y over delta t. And so we basically divide the change in y by the change of the time. And we obtain a solution delta y by simply multiplying the known step size with the value of fi, which we can calculate by inserting the current state of the system into the function f that we know. And that is here shown. So delta y we don't know, but we know delta t, and we know f, and we know the previous state. Sometimes that method is also called the Euler-Cauchy method, and it basically results in a series of t values that here is given as the next t value is just the previous t value plus delta t, and we can also recursively calculate the formula for the next value of y, and that is given here. So y in dimension I at time j plus 1 is given as y in dimension I at the previous time j plus delta t times what f is, f of the time value from before and the solution from before. So there is a linear interpolation between the different time steps. So by using that, we approximate the function. And of course, there is, however, some error involved. In every time step, we move a little bit away from the real solution of the system. And how large that error is, these inaccuracies you can actually precisely calculate by looking at the Taylor expansion of the system, and that is done here. Now let's just neglect most of that Taylor expansion and just look at the first few terms in that expansion, and we see that Euler basically defines the first order accurate term of the Taylor expansion, and everything else that comes after that in the Taylor expansion is going to be the error. And of course, that error will become larger and larger. So the error is hence in the order of O of delta t square. So you see that here in that example, we have here plotted d dt. These are the green dots, that is the actual rate of change in every time step. The blue line is the analytic solution, and then delta, or that triangle, that red triangle, marks Euler's method that is a little bit off the solution. Yeah? So that is a system that you can see here now written. The derivative of y is 6 times t plus 2. That's something we can directly solve, and therefore we can here see that Euler's method is very close, but a little bit off. Yeah? So, of course, the more time points, I should say, the more densely packed you have these, the closer you get to the line. So here you see that if you have a smaller step size, then you get closer and closer to the system. So if you have very, very small steps, then Euler's method will get closer and closer to the analytical solution. Yeah. But then, of course, you also increase the runtime. Remember, at each time point, you have to evaluate the entire system. That means an abstract syntax tree, and that is complex. Now, an idea to improve Euler's method would be to not only calculate the first value at the beginning of every time step, but also take into account that there is something in between at half of that way. Yeah? So the problem is that Euler's method only calculates at each time step the first value and then assumes that there is a linear change until the next time step. So if you take a midpoint, then we can make a more detailed estimation. So how would we do that? So we basically calculate K1 as before. So K1 is just what would be Euler's method. But then we also calculate K2 at half the time interval. And here we insert that change that we calculate from K1, and then add that K2 to the previous time solution, and then get the next. So in other words, we can also see that here. So we're basically making a more complex formulation where we take into account a approximation of the system at half of the time step. Yeah, just inserting the formula, and then you will get what is written here. Yeah. So now the series of time steps is still tj plus 1 equals tj plus delta t, or t naught plus j, the number of time steps so far, times delta t. So, and here there's, you can still write down the series of values that we get. And that is what the integrator basically gives us, a table of discrete numbers, and there is nothing smooth. It's actually just numbers that look smooth when we have very small time intervals and possibly an interpolation between these values that is possibly not linear. So sometimes that midpoint method is also called second order Runge-Kutta method, after these German mathematicians Runge and Kutta, who lived also more than 100 years ago, or roughly 100 years ago. And then were born in the 19th century and then lived until the mid of the previous century. So now that second order Runge-Kutta method can be further improved, yeah, because it still has an error in it. And that error we see from the Taylor expansion again. It's of course now a smaller error, but it's second order accurate. Now let's look at that plot again. So we have here the same plot, just a different system. So we have the blue curve showing the analytical solution, and then we have here the rate of change marked in green in every time step. Then we have Euler, and we have here now in blue squares the second order Runge-Kutta method. And you see that Runge-Kutta is second order is already much closer to the real solution. So now, if we compare for this example now here, Euler's method against the midpoint method, we can see that the analytical solution here for that system, y prime equals 3 times y, gives us e to the 3 times t, and you can see that here now Euler's method is much further apart for that longer time step. So the observation is that the midpoint or second order Runge-Kutta method is better than Euler's method, but it's still not ideal because it's not identical to the analytical solution, because we have here now still an approximation error in it that is dependent on y. So an improvement would be the fourth order Runge-Kutta method, so we can further increase the accuracy of the system by adding an additional intermediate time step and then make that calculation a bit more complex. And you can see there, it's called fourth order Runge-Kutta method because there are four values that we take into account, and they basically split up the time interval more and combine them again and then give us the next value. So it has a much lower approximation error, further increases, however, it further increases the computational costs because we have to evaluate the system 4 times per time step. And in each time step, we have to evaluate all the syntax trees. Therefore, it is becoming much more computationally expensive, of course. But it allows us to take longer time steps because we take into account changes in between. So there's still an approximation error, but now it's a fourth order accurate in O of delta t to the 5. Now, let's compare these different methods, so Euler versus midpoint versus fourth order Runge-Kutta, and we can see that as we expect for that example situation, 3 times y as our derivative of the function y, we can see that we get closer and closer to the real solution. But of course, with large step size, we are still at a situation where we have fixed step sizes, and that can be a problem if we have large changes in some variables. Therefore, an idea to overcome that would be to have a step size adaptation. So the idea is, in areas of low change or small change, we do large steps, whereas in areas where there's a lot of change, we would make a smaller step and decrease the step size, the time step size. And to be able to do that, we have to actually calculate the expected error in each time step and take that into account. So a possible approach would be to compare the result for identical delta t values using 2 different methods, for instance, second and fourth order Runge-Kutta, and then see what the divergence is. And then, depending on that comparison, we would choose the step size. So we can apply another method. So we can calculate if we have y1 being the result of the full step and y2 being the half step, that results in an epsilon, that is the difference between the full step and the half step, and that gives us the error that we can calculate. And then we compare that error epsilon and to an error tolerance epsilon naught that we define. And then in each time step, we want to have that error tolerance being surpassed. And so we calculate the next time step length as delta t from the previous time step times the absolute value of the error tolerance over the observed error and take the nth root out of that, and n is here the order of that integration method. So basically, that means we have many additional calculations to make, so adaptive time step calculation is much more computationally expensive. Here, for making one time step, we have to evaluate the system 11 times, and that means that we have a factor with which the evaluation time increases. And also, there's a very important problem that you have to be aware of, and that is the machine precision. So if the step size gets closer and closer to zero, we can reach a situation in which that delta t is, from the machine's perspective, already exactly zero. Yeah, at some point, there's a certain range that the machine can still consider with double precision numbers. And if you get too close to zero, then at some point the machine will assume that is zero, and then the program will never terminate because you're making zero steps, and then you can't solve the system anymore. So there were newer methods developed after Runge Kutta that I only want to mention. So one would be, or they're falling mainly in the class of predictor-corrector methods. So until now, we only considered the current value y and the integration time step. But these predictor-corrector methods, they would make a prediction for the next time step and then have a correction step in which they check if the prediction was correct and then, for instance, decrease the time step to make or make some other calculation to adjust the method. Examples of that are the Adams-Moulton-Bashford method. For instance, it's better than Runge-Kutta, but it's very difficult to implement. And then there's also the Burlish-Storr method that falls into that category. So here we would explore the space of the solution, making a large step and then making smaller steps in between, and then check if the prediction for the next step is correct or not, or it has to be adjusted. So the implementation of that method is a bit easier, but it still is, of course, computationally more expensive and not suitable for some difficult functions which are not continuous or have singularities in it. It's less stable, numerically stable, as the Adams-Moulton-Bashford method. But now let's take a look into the glycolysis and apply that here. So we have a steady state situation, as we know, so two reactions, reaction channel 1 and reaction channel 2. And now we have the mass action rate laws for that. And now we have here parameter values that we insert and initial values that we assume. And we can run a simulation. So with fourth order Runge-Kutta with a fixed step size of 0.01 second, we can, for instance, get a simulation that that looks like that. Now, what happens if we change the simulation conditions? Now, all of a sudden, we dramatically decrease rate constant plus one, and at the same time also drastically change k minus one, basically actually changing every rate constant very strongly, but some are decreasing, some are increasing. So you can see that here we have ratios of for k plus 2 being 100, and here for the k minus 2 is only 0.1, so numerically much, much smaller, 1,000 times a numerical difference. Of course, the units are different, but the scale of the numbers is also still far apart. And now what we observe here is now the system actually is defined so that dehydroxyacetone phosphate decays very, very fast and instantly almost, whereas the glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate surpasses 0.5 molar. So if we now look at that system again and use a fixed step size fourth order Runge-Kutta, so no step size adaptation, we wrongly get a situation in which we observe a negative concentration. So that is now invalid, an invalid situation, because we have so dramatic changes in that system that the integration method calculates a wrong result where we get negative concentrations. And that is what we call stiffness here. So that is basically an effect that we see because we have large changes in one metabolite and less large changes in others, and the order of magnitude of the changes is diverging a lot, and therefore we can't, if we use a fixed step size without step size adaptation, then it's not possible to make a precise calculation for the next value. And even with adaptive step size, it could happen that we have to make smaller and smaller and smaller steps until the machine precision is reached, and then we would have no termination of the algorithm. So here's some mathematical definition of what step size, stiffness means. So it has something to do with the eigenvalues of the ordinary differential equation system. And we can determine ahead of time if a system is stiff or not using these eigenvalues and looking at their real parts. There are specific numerical integration methods that can deal with stiff systems. Examples are Rosenbrock's method that we didn't discuss here now in detail, which is also called ODE23S, Adams, Moulton, Bashford, and so forth. They are able to deal with stiffness, but other methods aren't. For instance, Euler, with its fixed step size, cannot deal with a stiff system. So that's a problem that you have to be cognizant of. So I just want to finish with a brief discussion of some advanced modeling techniques that we can have also in our biological systems. So until now, we had the derivative of the concentrations as a function stoichiometric matrix times V, and that only depended on x and time, and of course the structure of the system. But now we can also introduce W, and P is the parameter vector that we always had, sometimes not made explicit. But now we can have here also W as an additional modulation matrix, and we can have here events and assignments that also interfere with that system. So W is a modulation matrix that gives us some kind of regulatory effects. So G is a rate rule function that gives us direct rates of change that you have to integrate. E is an event function and R is an assignment function. So that is a more complex system, and that is basically what is described by the format that we have in SBML. Not only the actual metabolic system with reactions, but also additional mathematical constructs. The consequence is that we have more, to use much more precise step size adaptation to find the exact time when an event triggers, and also need solvers that are more precise if we want to deal with such situation. So in Euler's method, for instance, is often not suitable for that. There can also be a delay. That means that we have to look up previous values again. And there can be additionally algebraic equations that determine the values of some compounds in the system. And if we have that in our models, that means that we have to execute more calculations. So an event, for instance, is defined as a function that takes the current concentration and the time, and then if a condition is satisfied, it fires, otherwise it returns zero. Examples can be a sudden pulse of nutrition in a fermenter. All of a sudden there's more nutrient available, and then that would be a firing event. Or there can also be events of the cell cycle in yeast, for instance. So here you see an example of a system that has events. All of a sudden something changes very dramatically, and then the system has to readjust, and that gives us some kind of an oscillating feature almost. There can be assignments in a system. That means that we have a direct assignment how a certain variable has to be calculated. Use cases are if we have to calculate certain chemical species or parameters based on some different statements that we know. Here's another example that uses that technique. So here, the total P53, which is a cytochrome, is being calculated using assignments here in that model, which you can find in the publication that is cited below. Just quickly some runtime considerations. So I mentioned that during that talk a few times, so that we have to always evaluate the entire tree. That means that if n gives us the number of edges and vertices summed up, then we have to do that as many times as we have time points to evaluate. And if we have to repeatedly evaluate these time points, then that is again multiplied with another factor. And for Euler's method, of course, there's a fixed step size. Therefore, we have O of t times n, where n is the number of vertices plus edges in the system. Of course, different numerical solvers have higher runtime, and that is also the motivation why sometimes you have to explicitly switch on adaptive step size integration, because it consumes more time and is often disabled if it's not directly needed. There can be more complex terms in these systems, such as events or assignment rules, algebraic rules, and they increase the runtime, of course, a lot. If you have events in a system where a trigger condition has to switch from false to true, that means that you have to hit exactly that time point in which that trigger condition changes, and that can be very difficult, and you will need a very precise solver for that. Sometimes it makes sense to use rules instead of events, which means that you define directly how something changes instead of defining a trigger condition, which is more time consuming. So to summarize, we have talked about a graph representation of our systems. If we use a graph instead of a matrix to computationally represent the system, then we have a more sparse representation, because most values in the stoichiometric matrix are zero, as you know. Here we have talked about a tree-based data structure that, and how equations can be transformed into directed acyclic graphs for and how we can save runtime by finding overlap between them. So then we talked about numerical integration. We talked about first-order Runge-Kutta, which is essentially the Euler method, and then improvements of it, second-order Runge-Kutta, or modified Euler, or midpoint method, as however you want to call it, and then the fourth-order Runge-Kutta method. Those are the fourth-order Runge-Kutta is a very well-suited method for many situations. Then also we talked about adaptive step size changes and the problem that you have to deal with, that you must not go beyond computer precision. We talked about the problem of stiff systems, that if you have either reached computer precision or have fixed step size and the changes are too large, then you will have stiffness and that leads to problems. We talked a little bit about advanced modeling techniques, events and rules, and also some other effects. I thank you for your attention and see you next time.